Welcome back guys, and in today's video we'll be talking about events. So an event is basically something which gets called in response to some sort of an action. So let's just see their implementation in blueprints. So let's just create a blueprint class. Let's just create an actor. Let's call it event test, and let's just drag that into our level. So if we open that, if we head over to our event graph, and this is where you'll handle all of your events. So you'll see three events. This is event begin play, event on actor begin overlap, and event tick. So I'll be getting into each of these now. So first let's start with event begin play. So whenever an actor respond, the begin play event of that actor is called. So as we did in the last video, so if I just hit print string, and if we go ahead and press play, you should see hello. The hello world exists because of what we did in the last video. We printed hello world over here. This is because when the level started, this begin play was called. Couple of things to note here, especially for multiplayer. So there is one issue with begin play. So let's say I am working on a multiplayer game. We'll be going over that in the multiplayer tutorial series, which I'll get really soon. So what happens is, sometimes let's say you spawn an actor during runtime on the server. So when you call something on begin play, it's generally a good practice, especially for things like characters, and especially if you're dealing with replicated variables, that you leave a slight delay, maybe about a second. This is because even though the actor is spawned on the server, and I'll get to why server in the multiplayer series. So what happens is, by the time it is successfully spawned on the client, this is called, and then it results in things happening not in the way they should. So yeah guys, that's the one limitation of begin play. You could just get over that by using some sort of a delay, and we'll be getting to delays and timers in the next video. Now let's head over to the next event, event on actor begin overlap. Okay guys, so now let's talk about event actor begin overlap. So this event gets called whenever you overlap this actor. So let's just test it out so that you guys know what I mean. So now if I just print hello, you'd see that nothing's really gonna happen. The reason is that it actually does not know that something has overlapped it. So you'll need some sort of a collision in order to detect that. So let's just type in box collision. Could have a capsule collision or a sphere collision, doesn't really matter. So now if I go ahead and overlap that, so I'm in simulate mode right now, so now if I overlap, you see it prints hello, which is exactly what we wanted. But now this raises another question: what is this other actor? So other actor is basically the object reference to the other actor which just overlapped. So in our case, it'll be the default pawn. So if you guys don't know, since there is no game mode here, so the way you get here is settings, world settings, and you see game mode override is none. So the pawn here will be the default pawn. So in theory, it should print out the default pawn. So now if we go ahead and overlap, and yeah, it did print it there, but just you could just disable hidden in game. You guys can just search hidden in game. You can just disable that so that you guys know that you're overlapping the box. So default pawn. So this is what we expected. So that's it for event actor begin overlap guys. And for multiplayer, you need to consider one thing. So if I just print the string again, and let's say I play with two players, and I have two player starts. So what you'll notice is, the moment I overlap, there are two hellos that are called. So one is on the client and the other one is on the server. Okay guys, so now let us talk about event tick. So event tick is an event which gets called every frame. So now if I just print a string on event tick, you'd see you're just spammed with these print strings. That's because it's printing them every frame, and this is purely dependent on your frame rate, the amount of times it's going to call this event tick. There is one setting that you could change. So if you head over to your if you go ahead and click on your actor, and you'd see tick interval in seconds. So if you type in 0.5, it's going to call it twice every second. So that is one thing that you can do. Generally for FPS games and other games where you want better performance, you just disable this tick. You wouldn't have tick enabled, but for our purposes we'll just leave it like this. And if you would print out this delta seconds, you should get 0.5 or something close to that. So that's it for event tick guys. It just runs on every frame, and again for multiplayer, this runs both on the client as well as the server, assuming that this object exists on both of them. So now let's go over their C++ implementation. So what you can do here is, if you go ahead and go to tools, new C++ class. So let's just create an actor class again, and then click next. We could call this, test. Okay, let's just call it cpp_test. So make this public, and then okay, let's just create the class. So now it's going to add the code and load up Visual Studio, and I'll see you guys after that. Okay guys, so now we are inside the C++ file of our actor class that we just created. So now let's just define a function. So for this we'll be using a specifier known as a macro known as u function. So this macro allows us to give a few specifiers that can make the function visible to blueprints. The other important macro you'll use in Unreal is called uProperty, which you use to expose variables to blueprints. We'll be getting to that when we talk about variables. So let's just use the two specifiers here. So one would be blueprint implementable event, and there is another specifier known as blueprint native event, but we won't be using that here. Basically the difference is that you can have your own C++ functionality as well along with that in native event. So let's just use blueprint callable. So what blueprint callable allows us to do is allow us to call this event just like any other blueprint event, and this is going to come in our override section, in our functions section, in our event graph. I'll be showing you guys about that. So now let's just create a function, and if you guys don't want this to appear as a regular function but instead more similar to a blueprint event, you should not have a return type. So void, let's just call this test event. Then let's just have let's say an integer. So this is an input parameter which I'm giving. So int random number, let's say. So that's basically it. That's all the setup we need. So let's just build this. Should hopefully have no compilation errors. And yeah, build succeeded. And the hot reload is complete. But I will restart the editor because I've seen that it crashes way too often. Okay guys, so now we are in the editor. Now, if I were to go to our event test, and then if I were to type in cpp, you would see a cast, but you don't really see the event. that's because this event test actor does not belong to our CPP underscore test class. So the way we can parent this is we can go ahead and go to class settings, go ahead and go to parent class and then change it, or alternatively you can just create an entirely new actor blueprint class. Then if you type CPP, you should see your CPP underscore test over here if you have done everything correctly. So let's just do it over here. So CPP underscore test. So once we have reparented it, let's just recompile. So now if you were to see here, you would see 21 overridable. So let's just click on test event. Now this will appear as an event, but as of now it doesn't really do anything. So as you can see, nothing. That's because I didn't we have dragged it over here. So yeah, so remember we had put that blueprint callable specifier. That's where it'll come handy. So we can type in test event, and then if I type in 100 for example, click on compile and play it, it's going to print hello again. So let's just head back in here and then just drag this random number onto our print string. So now we get 100 on the top left hand corner. So that's it for this video guys. Thanks for watching. If you do like this content, make sure you do leave a thumbs up as well as sub to the channel, and make sure you do join the Discord server, and see you guys in the next one where we'll be talking about the variable types.